الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وبعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته dear brothers and sisters professors and all other distinguished scholars fellow presenters and researchers I greet you in the name of the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh again. This is Namungo Hamza from House of Zakah at Nwakaf, Uganda. And we are, and my co-author, Professor, Associate Professor Dr. Yusuf Haji Othman. We are very happy for having been chosen as one of the paper or article writers and eventual presenters on this excellent conference titled the International Conference on Contemporary Issues in Islamic Finance 2020. It has a lot of themes, wonderful ones, but we choose to go with Islamic social finance, and that is Zakah, to be specific. Our topic is access to finance and improved welfare, a case study of House of Zakat and Wakaf Uganda in achieving sustainable development goals in selected districts in Uganda. Introduction of our paper. As House of Zakat and Wakaf Uganda is a Muslim charity organization legally registered as a company limited by guarantee in 2010. So the organization has been in existence for close to 10 years. Its legal mandate or its legal nature is that of a company limited by guarantee. Uganda is a secular state, which doesn't favor, which doesn't persecute. It gives, in simple terms, it gives freedom and space for each and every religion to participate. It can encourage certain religion's followers to do something as far as it's in line or it's in the benefit of the national security. So Zakah is not regulated by government. It's done out of the will of Muslims in Uganda. The House of Zakah and Wakaf Uganda was set up to streamline the collection and distribution of Zakah and preservation of Wakaf in Uganda. In the year 2010, now, the organization's primary commitment is to facilitate the performance of the third pillar of Islam in the country, that is Zakah. Its core values are transparency, accountability, professionalism, community interest before personal interest. House of Zakah and Wakaf Uganda was established in 2010 legally, but it started to operate in 2011. Before that, Zakah management in Uganda could hardly be described as institutional. This means that ever since Islam entered Uganda in 1844, that's around 175 years plus, there hasn't been, or there was nothing like an institution dedicated to Zakat collection and management. Before, it was the Muslim Supreme Council, certain Muslim sects and communities sharing the same aspirations, sharing the same tests, or sharing the same objectives in as far as driving Islam is concerned in the country. So they could set up their Zakah funds, but not registered legally. So you could see that it couldn't be called, it couldn't effect, or it wouldn't have a bigger impact on the country. The organization, that is House of Zakah, has been a source of financing since 2014, as shown in the first table below. Here, you could look at, we mentioned in our paper that we are going to look at three districts, Ntungamo, Iganga, Wakiso, and those are three districts we are going to look at. In 2014, the House of Zakat distributed 15 million in Ntungamo and another 15 million in Iganga. and 15 million in Wakiso district. The total went on consistently until in 2016, when all districts were, 2015, all districts were given 25 million, and 16, the same amount, 17, the same amount. In 2018, Wakiso was given more money, that is 20 million, more than Iganga and Ntungamo districts. Ntungamo districts is in the Western Uganda. We want to show the regional balance or the country balance in Zaka location. And as far as Zaka location is concerned, Ntungamo is in the Western Uganda and Wakiso in the central, Iganga in the east. Of all regions, the eastern region has more poor people, uneducated people, or it's unprivileged, more unprivileged than the other regions. When we continue with our introduction, we're trying to look at the Sustainable Development Goals, or call them the SDGs. SDGs has been one of the cardinal aims for different nations. Each nation, each community, each non-government organization, be it faith-based organizations like Zaka institutions in the Southeast Asia, Malaysia, Indonesia, Singapore, now in Africa, Sokoto State in Nigeria, House of Zaka, Sudan, and SANZAF in South Africa, all across the globe, they have been trying to align their Zaka distributions programs to the SDGs. Remember, SDGs are 17, are 16 virtually. The 17th one calls for partnerships for achievement of the goals. This is when we are now mentioning faith-based organizations, that each and every organization has to, or as a matter of achieving the SDGs, there should be unity and cooperation. Now, how the micro-level targets are broken down into real-world programs and practice, how they are delivered, how they are financed, and how individuals and economies affected remains a challenge for discussion and debate when implementing SDGs. There are many challenges to certain Zaka organizations, to certain charity organizations. Some of them are born out of strategic planning. Some of them are born out of madhab interpretation. Some of them are born out of capacity to do, capacity to think, capacity to align. So how these SDGs have been interpreted and how they've been aligned and how they've been implemented in the local or grassroots levels has left a big void in as far as achieving them is concerned. This is the reason why you see good reports, you see everything good in discussions, statistics are there, but when you go back on the ground, you still see the same challenges. So this is born out of interpretation. Meanwhile, bridging the gap, bridging the link between global SDGs agenda with the local level implementation targets. Therefore, it needs to be translated into action at the grassroots level. Again, about SDGs, they require proper institutional arrangement at vertical and horizontal levels with the capacity to take on the agenda forward. The easiest way to achieve some of the SDGs is accessing finance by households at the grassroots level so that they can start small scale businesses to increase their household incomes. Therefore, as a result of that, policymakers, researchers, financial institutions have conducted various studies to ascertain the extent to which the access to finance can improve welfare or levels of needy and poor people and therefore attain SDGs. Accessing finance, access to savings rather than finance leads to support positive economic outcomes for women, including increasing productivity and profits and greater investment in their businesses. So here, the researcher tells us that access to finance alone is just a means of achieving the ends. So he's telling us that saving, access to savings or ability to save is much more positive. It's much more close to increasing productivity and profits and greater investment. Therefore, access to finance alone should just be the means into achieving stability. Despite various policies that have been put in place by different governments, people's welfare status remain a global phenomenon, ranging from developed to developing countries, especially nations dominated by Muslim communities. And that's why our aim of the study looked at zakah in the Muslim communities and countries, especially in those that are developing. If zakah is well used in relation to charity, as one of the five pillars of Islamic faith, a bigger percentage of Muslims will raise their welfare status. That's a fact, because everything is there to see. If you are to read history or go back into history, you look at the period of Caliphate Umar bin Abdul Aziz, when zakah was able to be to fill all the gaps, income gaps and inequality gaps that were there before, and no one could ask for zakah. They reached a point. So history and statistics is there to tell us that it's possible. The global financial crisis has given the ability to various governments to find and budget for additional resources to support public needs for health, education, but such action had less success to wealth improvement among poor people. So here, governments have to play a role of supervising, of regulating, and at the same time of financing the gaps that remain between what zakah or what charities could offer. We all understand that in some countries, like here in Uganda, zakah Muslim community make up 14% of the total population, and resource wise, that tells you that nothing can be done to cover the whole poor communities in the country. Therefore, government, apart from playing a regulatory role and supervisory role, government should also ensure through policies and action that welfare of individuals are improved if finance is to be accessed. Government should empower institutions' effort to enable the poor access financial services. This study now examines the extent which access to finance through the House of Zakah has improved welfare levels of the people, as well as achieving SDGs in Uganda. We're looking at certain SDGs that align to the amount of money that was distributed. We know there are 17, they are very wide, but we're trying to narrow down to certain categories, 1, 2, 3, or 4. Uganda has been chosen because despite being a Muslim minority country, its member of the OIC, or the Organization of Islamic Cooperation, its Muslim community is vibrant. Despite being 14%, the community is vibrant, the community is visible. So therefore, they should be able to pay and utilize zakah accordingly. Secondly, House of Zakah is used because it is the first and only institution dedicated to zakat management in Uganda. There are now other institutions that are starting out. Some are new, some are less organized, some are not. They're there, but this institution is the first and is still the leading zakat management organization in the country. Thirdly, SDGs are used due to their mutual intention with zakat of improving people's welfare. Both SDGs and zakah strive to achieve the same objective, though methodologies in how to go about how to implement their policies or their objectives will differ in certain terms. If you're looking at our conceptual framework, we have independent variable being access to finance, in this case zakah. We have moderating variable. As we've seen, government has a role to play, and the knowledge or humility of zakat managers have an impact on the success of zakat itself. If they are less knowledgeable, if they are less discreet, that means zakat management or its effectiveness will be affected. Our independent variable comprise of improved welfare, and we're looking at access to education, access to healthcare, improved source of income, improved feeding, and improved methods of agriculture. So once zakah is used well or is allocated effectively, it should be able to reduce or to impact people's lives in those aspects mentioned above, and therefore improve people's welfare. However, there are other factors besides Inca, besides Seka as access to finance and improved welfare. There are those factors that still will lead to persistent low welfare standards amongst the people. One of them is level of education, two, number of dependents have available in the family, types of investment, purpose of finance, gender, age, and limited skills. If the factors are available, or those factors are at play in the community, access to finance and improved welfare will have a certain challenges to be met. The conceptual framework tells us that access to finance, which is a dependent variable from the household Zaka, improves welfare. It shows that access to finance is used to enable students to access or pay education services, health services, and alike. Households that engage in agriculture are enabled through improved methods of agriculture, like accessing improved seeds and fertilizers, which are essential for high productivity. Chapter 3 looks at methodology. First, we're looking at data. The study used primary and secondary data methods for collection. Primary methods of data collection were used to extract primary information from the participants. The fact that secondary information becomes outdated with time, the researchers used primary information to relate access to finance and improved welfare. The information was obtained using SPSS. Now, the information was obtained using tools or instruments like administrative questionnaires and interview guide. Secondary methods included newspapers, journals, textbooks, brochures, and the Holy Quran and the Hadith were all studied to complement the study. Study population, size, and determination. The study was informed by the community, Muslim community, such as Muslim leaders at regional levels in the various, in those three districts we've mentioned, and household leaders or heads that who received zakat. Sample size was 384, or was determined using Cochrane formula according to Ajay and Mika 2014. Data analysis. Quantitative data were collected and entered into SPSS for analysis. Qualitative information was used throughout the research. An analysis was done thematically as per objective of the study. Most of the information which was analyzed under this perspective came from the documentary review and the key informants. The findings could be seen in tabular form, and the discussions will lead. Cows, we're looking at before accessing finance, how were these families, how were they financially or socially? We are looking at those who had less, and in terms of goats, in terms of sheep, and in terms of chicken. We're looking at animals and livestock and poultry, because districts that are far away from the city center, Kampala, have land, have resources, have space to engage in livestock farming. But what they lack are the birds and the animals to rear. In that sense, therefore, it was prudent for the House of Zaka to give them such, because it would be effective for their locations. Findings and discussions, results in the table 4 here show high percentage of Muslim, how percentages from Tungamo district, 66%, Wachiso 96, Igang 99, for the participants who did not have cows before accessing finance from the House of Zaka. 3, this implies that participants' responses to the number of goats, Tungamo, Wakiso, and Niganga, sheep, and others, and partly chicken participants in Wakiso and Tungamo districts. Only participants from Niganga had some chicken, but it was also on small scale. The results show that people who accessed finance had less wealth in terms of animals that are normally kept as a source of income and food. This table shows access to finance before. This is okay. This is after accessing finance. Table 5. From table 5, it is indicated that the number of participants whose scores increased after accessing finance from House of Zakat is much higher. It shows 15% of the participants were able to own more than 7 cows, 5% if the participant owned 6 to 4 to 6 cows, and 61 owned 1 to 3 cows. The percentage of Muslims without cows in Tungam also reduced from 66 to 19%. Such decrease in the number of people without cows show that access to finance from the House of Zakat Waqf improved people's welfare and can easily transform individuals' lives into achieving the SDGs. Findings and discussions. Here we are looking at other factors for persistent levels of welfare. Despite the access to finance, there are those factors that will still trickle into the equation, which are limited skills, age, land tenure system, investing in poor avenues, low levels of education, poor methods of agriculture. And if you look at the response from the respondents, you'd look at a bigger percentage of respondents, especially on gender and limited skills, disunity, poor agricultural methods, land ownership in terms of women, they all agree that those factors are at play. However, low levels of education had less response in terms of agreeing. Many disagreed that it leads to consistent low levels of welfare. Findings and discussions continued. Number six showed that various factors for persistent low levels of welfare among Muslims in Uganda, despite presence of House of Zakat and Waqf Uganda. The researchers started with low levels of education among Muslim communities. However, results show that 55.3% of the participants disagreed and 16.9% strongly disagreed with the statement, while 15% were not sure, 12.2% agreed, and 0.6% strongly disagreed. Findings show that there are varied responses towards personal levels of welfare as a result of low levels of education. Participants who agreed with the statement were in line with the research carried out by the World Bank in 1990 and the UN in 1995, in which it was found that low levels of welfare has various factors among different communities and low levels of education as mentioned as a significant factor. However, both the results from the United Nations and the World Bank are in congruence that not all people with low levels of education have low levels of welfare. Findings, you can look at them in this table. At the interest of time, we can summarize them here. The regression analysis presented in table 7 shows both standardized and non-standardized coefficients, t-test and significance. Using the significance column, it is indicated that factors like education is low, or a value of 0.406, gender, age of a person, land tenure system, are non-significant factors for the percentile levels of welfare, despite accessing finance from the House of Zakat. For the case of these factors, the null hypothesis attached to them is maintained. On the second hand, factors like investing in poor avenue, accessing finance without clear purpose, disunity, among the others, are highly influenced levels of welfare among Muslim communities. In such circumstances, the null hypothesis is rejected in favor of the alternative. In conclusion, the researcher found that there is a relationship between access to finance from the House of Zakat Waqf Uganda and improved welfare among Muslim communities. However, this relationship is achieved when two factors are taken into consideration. One, proper administration of finance by House of Zakat Waqf administrators at an institutional and administrational at a personal level. At an institutional level, the administration of finance includes outlined guidelines for the distributors, administrators, transparency, exhibiting true nature of Islamic religion as laid down by the Prophet. At the personal level, it includes setting a purpose for the access to finance and following it to the end. Besides, the relationship is more observed when access to finance access is rated well in line with the investment avenue and when individuals should start repaying. Recommendations. Among the recommendations of the study include improving the welfare of individuals universal to living, to the living of individuals. Programs for improving the standards of the people seek to provide water, food, health services, accommodation, and daily or monthly sources of income. It is upon this perspective that the study finds a need for both institutional and personal administration of the people using finance from the household sector. Thank you very much for giving me or for giving us the opportunity to present our article on this wonderful conference. Alhamdulillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.